Thank you, Bruno, for this very clear and interesting talk. I think we will have many people willing to know more about your time domain simulations and the homogenization techniques, maybe. So please, people, any question is welcome. You should unmute your microphone first, or write on the chat.
I have a question.
Yes.
Do you
hear me? Yes.
I have a question about about homogenization at the end.
Yes,
I don't understand the presence of the shock. There is a picture with the energy. Yes, after, yes, here. So which energy decreases for the homogenized case?
Yes, yes. Here I represent the energy of both the microstructured solution, the reference case, which is in blue here. It is in blue here again. And the energy also on the first order homogenized solution. And the first order solution, homogenized solution, satisfies equations, this type of equation, which is the same than the P system that you may.
Yes. Okay. So homogenized satisfies this system.
Exactly. So here
it's the system with a source term.
Exactly. So the homogenized, the first order solution is the sum of two terms. A first zeroth order term, which is written here, which corresponds to the P system of fluid mechanics. And as you well know, you are a specialist of that topic. There is a time operation of shocks. You cannot avoid. And there are two additional terms, but which do not modify the energy balance, because it's only local corrections. If there is a shock, it will not modify the solution.
Okay. So the microstructured system has no shocks. Huh?
Exactly. It's dérangeant. It's a little bit not annoying. It's a little bit paradoxal. So the original system, it corresponds to linear wave propagation inside each cell, so there is no shock. Characteristics are parallel to the wave speeds, and the non-linearities occur at the interface but do not create a shock. So, okay. as large amplitude you get, you won't get a shock, so you will have conservation of energy. On the contrary, in the homogenized case, there will be shocks, there will be characteristics going through the mean velocity, as in the systems of Rankine-Ugonu equations and things.
Okay, so in some sense, it means it is a defect of the homogenized system.
Exactly. It's a limitation that is not often encountered, because many often people work with linear homogenization, so they cannot see such problem. Usually, there is also a time limitation in homogenization. There are many recent works of Grégoire Haller, Agnès Lamarck, and people like that who have illustrated the fact that, in fact, after a critical time, the dispersive effects, even in the linear case, required to take into account higher order developments. Instead of looking at first order, you must go up to second order homogenization. And there are many recent works on that topic, especially works of Boyan Guzina, Rémi Cormaggia, and people like that, who obtain second order homogenization. And in fact, you obtain wave equation with fourth order terms in space, time, and space and time. Dispersive, which is by nature, it is dispersive, and it can describe very accurately the dispersive effect. But here, it's It's not exactly the same thing. It means it depends on the amplitude. It is an intrinsic limitation of homogenization. There is a sort small of, a small of inadequacy of the model due to homogenization. And if we want to go further, which is a very, very interesting topic, and we will try to address it in the future, we must go also one order further. But we must be a little bit more clever than only writing zeroth order solution plus first order solution plus second order solution, because the zeroth order, the cascade of equations, means that the zeroth order solution won't be modified by the other terms. So the zeroth order solution will develop shocks. So we must be more subtle and incorporate in a single system both zero, first and second order equations. And I think it's quite similar once again to works done in fluid mechanics with the typical derivation of Serre-Green-Nardi equations or things like that.
Okay. Thank you. Very interesting. Yes.
So thank you, Stefan. Any other question? I don't see any hands raised.
If you want, I can.
Can you hear me all right? I've got a question in the chat, but I just
Alicia?
Wanted to ask. Thank you for the talk. It was really interesting. I just wanted to know what you're currently doing on this, and how you want to develop it further.
Excuse me, my English level is beginning. So could you do it again slowly?
Sorry. I put my question in the chat, if that's easier for you to read.
No, you can ask your question then.
So just current work. What would you like to do next, basically?
I'm not sure to understand the question.
What would you like to do next, Bruno?
The current works on ongoing research. Excuse me. The topic on higher order homogenization of nonlinear cases will be began very soon. I think it's very, very attractive. For me, it's a fundamental feature. Otherwise, there are other topics concerning you have seen I have spoken about resonant media and about nonlinear media. And in fact, we can mix them. And there are many interesting things to do with nonlinear resonant media. And especially, we can think about waves in waveguides with resonant system, for instance, membranes or Helmholtz resonators with large amplitude waves. And in fact, I've begun to work a few years ago on that topic because of works with a LOM team with Olivier Richoux and Jean-François Mercier in Poems, with systems involving both resonances and dispersive effects. And there are very attractive things to study because, in fact, there is competition between two effects, between the nonlinear effects which sharpen the fronts and the dispersive effects which widen them. And if there is a good competition between both, there can be an equilibrium which is reached. And it's typically the case of solitary waves, which are well known in nonlinear media. And we have it in mind for collaboration in particular with guys in the LOM, with Vassos, Akileos, I see his name here, and many other guys from a theoretical, numerical, and experimental point of view.
Okay, great. Thank you. Yeah, it's very interesting. A little bit beyond me, but yeah, thank you so much.
Thanks.
Bruno, I've got a naive question on the homogenization side. So far, I think your talk was on the scalar case, these anti-plane shear waves, or how does this translate to in-plane elasticity, for instance?
Yes, it's not a so naive question. So concerning the cracks, for instance, yes, we have done a work which is not still published on linear cracks, but with full elasticity, which means that they are in 2D, they are typically P and S wave, waves, and with tensors of contact loads, which means that there are four jump conditions with normal and tangential masses and springs, coupling what happens on the interface. And one can perform the derivation, and it's a little bit intricate from a tensorial point of view, but it's, there is no intrinsic difficulty. And we are currently studying the problem numerically. All the effective tensors are derived, but it remains to do the numerics. However, the extension to nonlinear case in higher dimensions is much more intricate, and for the moment, I don't know how to do it. Because in fact, the nonlinear case I have presented here is I find it very nice, but it masks real difficulties in 2D or S. Here we can perform all the computations of cell problems, nonlinear cell problems, analytically, and in higher space dimensions it's not possible. So it's another nonlinear homogenization is a full-time job for a specialist of solid mechanics and things like that. So perhaps I will try in the future, but in collaboration with specialists.
Actually, I have a second naive question. It's regarding Pendry's lens. Can your package handle John Pendry's lens, but for in-plane elasticity?
At the current time, the answer is no, because we have not taken the time to do it. But if there is interest in doing that, I think it's very straightforward, because we have understood the structure of the problem. And the structure means that, in fact, as you have seen, there is a very small modification of the partial differential equations. There is a coupling with auxiliary fields. Mm-hmm. And both the numerical methods for the propagative parts and the numerical parts are, in fact, there are many small changes. So if you think that there is a intellectual interest in looking at it, I think you can do it very, very fastly. Yes.
There is a little twist. Your elasticity tensor would not have the minor symmetry, but we could somehow play the trick of making it symmetric, introduce. So it would be a negative, definite, non-fully symmetric tensor.
Alors, perhaps it's more, it requires more work, I think. Right. It needs to be studied. From a formal point of view, I would say it's direct, but if there are fundamental changes in the mathematical properties of the tensors and things like energy balance, it requires some investigation, but we can discuss it when you.
And for our own delight, could you play again the flat lens?
Yeah, of course. But,
yeah, thanks. So could you describe again what you put in the slab? Of course, it's a dispersive medium you put in the slab.
Yes. So right, left and right, it's acoustic air. It's and in the slab, it's a dispersive medium with Lorentz coefficients, both in the density and in the compressibility, which corresponds to the media I have described previously. And the source is excited at a given frequency, 678 Hz by memory, where the medium, the sandwich medium, has an acoustic index equal to minus one.
Okay. So what is quite striking is that, you know, on the exit, we see more like a propagating wave than yet than a focusing, you see it.
Yeah. Yes, but if you make a slice, you will see that there will be a maximum, which is exactly at the right theoretical place. But
after, right.
The, in fact, the interference may, and the geometrical decrease makes that this maximum decreases, and the maximum always is maintained at this place, which is exactly the symmetrical than the source point.
Alors, there is something that would be fantastic to study for you is if you have an array of perfect lenses. So you should space each lens by an equal amount of air. Mm. But instead of having just one lens, you would have like 10 of them.
And I imagine that the source image becomes the source point of the next one and so on and so on.
This remains to be shown. See, I'm not sure that the image you get on the right-hand side will act really as a source for the next lens. Or at least you should check this for two lenses, you know, just to make that would be very interesting to see if this is what happens or not.
And it can be done quite fastly because, in fact, for the preparation of the talk, I have done this film this weekend, as you know, and it takes this time. 10 minutes, this one. So you make a multiplication of 10 minutes, but in fact, in 1 hour, you can have an array of six lenses.
Anyway, thank you very much. I will stop with my questions. It's really fascinating.
Okay.
Anyone else for the questions? If not, let's thanks again, Bruno, for sharing this interesting results. Very, very, and see you next week with Fernando Guevara Vasquez from University of Utah, in, USA. And stay safe and bye, everyone.
Thanks a lot for this kind invitation. Bye.
Thank you, Bruno.
Bye.